very old-fashioned.
Good. Let's resume our workshop, and let's cover now the second presentation that we have on the program. First of all, you've been provided with this very modern-looking instrument. I can reassure you, it's not the latest model of cell phone that the ECB is providing to its employees. Otherwise, that would not be a very good illustration or anticipation of the modernization that we can bring to our market infrastructure, for sure. So that's a voting device. Leave it aside. I mean, still close to you, because at a certain stage of my presentation, I'm going to raise questions and to foster a bit the participation of the audience and to make the presentation a bit more interactive. We have been very creative, and so keep it close. Now, the presentation that I'm going to cover now, it roughly corresponds to the second chapter of this report that I hope you have all read very carefully, and not only this morning coming to Frankfurt, but before that. The first chapter of this report was mainly covered by Marco this morning. I'm going to cover more or less what corresponds to the second chapter, and Patrick this afternoon will logically cover the third one. It's not exactly the same items, because the second part is supposed to be functional, the last part business, but sometimes the border between the two domains is a bit blurred, so that's why we have slightly adjusted. So I'm going to cover the remittance of the remittance and payments data, the possibility that we would have to enrich the data that we transport in the payment messages, the question of the opening hours of Target, the multi-currency services or the multi-currency approach, the account management or the account setup, and I will close with the openness to new technologies. I would invite you to raise your question as they come, because otherwise we have quite a number of topics, and if we take them all at the end, that may be a bit difficult, and it's not necessarily bringing a high level of interaction. So please do not hesitate to interrupt me. That is a slide that also Patrick is having on his presentation. It is just translating the approach that we have adopted throughout this presentation and also throughout the report. It's somehow showing our recipe for the next generation of our TGS system, where mainly we see three ingredients. The first one is to capitalize on what we have, because we have a system, we have a Target 2 system that is now well established and we hope is giving satisfaction to most of our participants, if not to all our participants. That's the first ingredient. The second one, as it was already explained by Mark and Marco, is to consider the opportunities that will be presented to us when the two platforms, so the one today hosting Target, the one hosting T2S, when these two platforms are consolidated or merged, and that is the part that is to be taken as a given, but it clearly presents some opportunities for the RTGS services. And then the last and third ingredient that we have to keep in mind that is very important is that we are not only building or rebuilding the current Target 2 system or the current TGS system. We aim at building the system for tomorrow and even for the day after tomorrow. Huh? You know that a lifetime of a market infrastructure is closer to 10 or 15 years than to a couple of years. So that means that the system that we have now or the foundation of which we are now establishing is most likely going to be operated by the euro system far beyond 2020. So it's not only a matter of looking at the business that you are carrying out now in the RTGS. It's also anticipating as much as possible the business that you would like to bring to us tomorrow and after tomorrow, and to anticipate how these things are going to evolve. That's the crystal ball, I would say, dimension of the exercise. But let's start with the first of these five topics which I will cover in my presentation. This topic, that's the remittance and payments data. It's obviously a topic that is linked to what Marco has presented before on the migration to ISO 20022. It's linked in the sense that we will move to standards which are richer, they can transport more information, and that gives us the possibility when we are using them in our TGS to transport more business information, which you would suggest to us. Now, let's just come back to the discussion that we had with our participants. I think it started in 2010-2011 when we have first issued some consultation on the migration to ISO. You know that we had planned to migrate target to ISO 20022 in basically two steps. First, that we migrate in like for like, so it's more the technical part, but we keep the same level of information which is transported across the participants. And it would have been only in the second stage, later on, that we consider the possible enrichment, so that we would go beyond the like for like. In the consultation that we had with the banks, I would say that the difficulty or the disagreement was not so much on the ultimate goal. There was, in general, a confirmation by most of the participants that they do see ISO as being the historical and logical development for market infrastructure, and that it would indeed become our future. The concerns that the banks have voiced were more because they did not really like this idea of first migrating like for like, and therefore having to invest already now or soon for the like for like, while the benefits that they can draw from this migration to ISO by transporting richer information would only come several years later, at a point which, by the way, at that time we had not really clarified. So it's it was more a disagreement on the way to get there than really a disagreement on the final objective, because, as I said, there was a relatively large majority of participants that supported a migration to ISO standards. So for all these reasons, we have decided, that was in October last year, that we postpone the migration of target to ISO. It was supposed to be in November 17. We said, no, we are not going to make it that way. We are going to move to ISO, but only in the context of this strategic review that we are having, which we are calling sometimes Vision 2020, and that we would aim, or we would give the possibility to the participants, if they are really supporting that approach, that we would possibly deliver everything at the same time. So the ISO capability and, together with it, also the possibility to transport richer information, so that from your perspective, from a financial viewpoint, you have the cost and the benefits more or less at the same time, and not with this time lag as it was firstly envisaged. Speaking about payment standards in general, you know that the FIN standards, which were those that we were using in Target so far, over the last year, their evolution has been extremely limited. There were a lot of initiatives that were taken by the banking sector that had to be either discarded or rescheduled, or the banks were invited to consider making these changes more on the ISO side, but not to touch so much on the FIN side, etc. It's mainly the regulatory changes that have recently influenced or enriched the FIN payment standards. So that's definitely something that we see as a positive step forward, that by now making use of ISO standards, we will forget about this relative rigidity that we have all been facing on the FIN standards so far. When we refer to richer payment messages. What do we mean? Well, it's actually, or what we anticipate, because what we mean, we'll have to come from you. But what we anticipate is that we are mainly speaking about information that has to be channeled throughout the chain. It's mainly information that one actor in the chain wants to pass to the other one, but not necessarily instructions on the basis of which the part in the middle, that is the ATGS system or the market infrastructure, has to take into account for processing the payment. So in other terms, we are mainly speaking about transporting information than really processing them from the viewpoint of the market infrastructure. That's why we anticipate that these discussions about how to enrich the payment standards and which payment standard to take, it's primarily an issue of standardization and less a functional issue from the perspective of the ATGS system. And for that reason, it's more likely to be these discussions are likely to be held in the standardization fora, in particular in ISO, and with the help of SWIFT as a registration authority for ISO. So that was about the background. In other terms, why are we bothering you with this topic in the context of the next generation of our RTGS system? Now, concretely, what could we speak about? Or what is at stake? I would say that it's not for us as Eurosystem, as operator of the infrastructure, neither in our role of Catalyst, to propose transporting new payment data in the messages that we will process in Target. It's obviously a discussion that shall be steered by the banks in the context of standardization bodies. Here, I just put some example on the slide. It's certainly not exhaustive, but we know that the list of possible candidates in terms of how to enrich the payment messages, the list of candidates is very long. You just need to compare a thin message like the MT103 with its equivalent in the ISO world, the PAC 08, if I recall correctly, to get convinced that the delta is very large. So all possibly or theoretically, all these information which are transported or can be transported in PAC 008 could be candidate for being transported as well in the standards that we are going to implement for our next RTGS system. You see already what I was pointing out before. We are mainly speaking about information that has to be passed from one actor in the chain to the next one or throughout all the actors in the chain. But we don't anticipate that there is a strong demand to remit particular settlement instruction to the RTGS. So we are, again, I repeat because that's important, we are mainly expecting that these information are things that we need to transport without truncating, but not necessarily to process on our side. The information which are at stake, it's basically of three categories. That can be a piece of information that today is not at all available in the payment standards that we are using. In particular, there are a lot of demands on an end-to-end reference that could be provided by the corporate initiating the payment. So these type of things are not really available in the standards. That could be added, so something not yet available. It could also be that you are considering extending the size of some of the fields that exist today, but it's limited. And the example we always give is the one of a reference on 16 characters, that you'd like that these existing fields are a bit expanded to transport more characters. Or the enrichment can also consist in information that are already transported in the thin messages, but not necessarily in a structured way or not sufficiently structured to allow some automation on your side. The classic example could be, for instance, the postal address, which is a kind of full text and which having it a bit more structured could allow some type of validation, for instance. So in other terms, that's what it will bring. That's why we want to consider the migration to ISO, because it will allow to transport more information or longer fields or more structured information. And that's certainly something in which you as participant can find value. I think that even beyond the payment standards from the ISO viewpoint, the review that we are now launching and that we want to carry out jointly with you could also be the opportunity to consider generalizing some the usage of data standards which have been developed in the meantime and we are not making use of in target. I have in particular in mind the LEI, the legal entity identifier. Today, because we are coming very much from a thin world, we are having a way to identify the banks, the participants in target that is very much BIC based. Also because the BIC was very useful to identify and in the messaging as well. Now, with ISO, with XML, that logic is not the same any longer. So perhaps we can, it's the right time to consider using the LEI a bit more broadly, also in the way we are identifying the participants or generally the parties in our new ATGS system. Again, that's something we are just throwing some ideas or giving you some illustration of what we would be ready to take on board, but the ball will be in your camp, mainly in the context of the standardization bodies. So the list is not exhaustive. However, to come somehow to a point that you were already raising before, Paola, we expect that the discussion, in particular in the standardization bodies, shall not be let's invent a new standard for target or for the Euro system, ATGS system. But that cannot be either that we speak about a payment standard that would be covering the different segments or the different business that is behind the payment business. Huh? So it's relatively unlikely that we adopt the same standards as those that are used in ACH world or retail world. What we have seen in the recent years is that there is a good case for developing worldwide standards for high-value payments, and it's most presumably the direction it's going to take. So that's what we expect, that there are standards which are built, which are specific not to us, but to the business of large-value payments. Now, the benefits that you can expect. The benefits, they are similar to those that the market can expect from a migration to ISO, because the two things, as I was saying before, they are closely intertwined. You can expect better integration of your applications with the other business segments that you have and which are making use already of ISO. Can refer, for instance, to the retail business or to the securities business. You can expect as well an optimization of the processing, for instance, of the corporate instructions whenever the payment is initiated by a corporate, that you can transport the information end-to-end. Today, if you have corporate standards which are a bit richer or largely richer than those that exist in FIN, you need to truncate or you need to find ways to transport in parallel this information, and that's extremely disruptive in the payment chain. So that's a value that certainly you would easily grasp. So at the end, the migration to ISO and the enrichment of the standards, that's what is really going to bring value to you, but also to your clients. I think that we can look at the migration to ISO and the enrichment of the payment standards as being the two sides of the same coin. But when you refer to migration to ISO, most of the time the participants and the banks, they see the cost. While when you refer to the enrichment of the payment standard, they tend to see more the value and the benefits. But actually, it's somehow the same the same topic here. Now, these are the expected benefits, but I would say there are also things that are important to keep in mind. I didn't want to present them as cost because it's not exactly what I mean. But while we are discussing, or when we are going to discuss all together and in the context of standardization bodies, these enrichment of payment messages, there are two or three ideas or I would say topic that we have to keep in mind. The first one is because there is a certain share of the traffic that we receive in Target that is neither initiated within the EU nor ultimately landing in the EU. And actually, I have here a very nice map that have been computed, which is looking at all the real origin of the payments which we are settling in Target and the real destination. And you see that these arrows or links, they go far beyond the very small territory of the European Union. So that's obviously linked to all the correspondent banking activities that may exist, or even the intra-group activity of these participants. But that is giving a good illustration of the extent to which Target 2 is not only a matter for European banks to decide on. Okay, now come back to this slide. There are indeed a world that is evolving in parallel to ours, which is the world of correspondent banking that we cannot completely ignore. The world of correspondent banking that is still largely relying, if not exclusively relying, on the FIN standards, and I think that will do so for quite a while. There are initiatives that have been launched. I think it was at Cybos last year, and Paola, you made reference to it. This Global Payments Innovation Initiative. However, because the correspondent banking is something, it's not centralized. It's per definition dissolved across all the banking communities. There is an absence of global governance, and we cannot expect that the migration of the correspondent banking to ISO is going to take place before a while, perhaps even after all of us in this room have retired. We have to see. But that's why that's an issue that we have to keep in mind. What it means if within Europe we are going ahead and reaching our payment messages, what is the degree of backward compatibility that we need to maintain and how to solve it? It's nothing new. I mean, this type of discussion was already taking place when the SEPA standards were introduced, where also a certain share of the retail transactions are initiated from outside the EU. But it's something that we need to take on board. How do we address that issue? Shall we have different set of standards? Shall we have some form of particular procedure to address that very important business case? That's something on which obviously we would like to get your input. The second point is that, and that's the point that you raised more specifically before, Paola, is that Target 2 is not the only large value payment system in the world. It's not even the only large value payment system in Europe, to our deep regret, but that's the way. We have in particular one large competitor, and that means that we have anticipated already that there would be a call from all our participants that are also participants in the other systems, that we shall not develop standards for Target. Actually, if we develop standards for Target, they are not standards in the sense of what you would expect from a standard. But it's certainly something that we keep. That's the logic that we want to apply throughout this process of enrichment of the payment standards. You know that there had been discussion in particular in Europe with Euro 1 when it came to defining the migration of Target 2 to ISO. There were some talks and harmonization and convergence on the way we have to migrate in Europe. And we certainly want to maintain that collaboration. And even beyond Europe, there are some fora that exist. There were some initiatives that have been launched, in particular by SWIFT, to bring SWIFT standards, to bring around the table the operator of the most important large value payment system. So it's in that context, or having in mind what the discussion that are taking place in this fora, that we should approach the enrichment of our payment standards to avoid the multiplication of standards for the same business case. Again, there will not be one standard for making any type of payment. I don't think that it would be appropriate. But at least for this segment on which Target is operating, at least for large value payments, we shall at any cost avoid that multiplication. And then the last point I wanted to draw to your attention is the fact that, and Marco has already touched upon it, when we are migrating Target to ISO and register the standards that we are using in ISO, it also means that implicitly we are accepting any future evolution of these standards. So we create a functional and also financial dependence. Today, you can say we already have it somehow. We are using FIN standards. If the FIN standards are developing, we need to implement them. But the governance of the decision on FIN standard and the governance on the evolution of ISO standards is not exactly the same. So the risk is higher that we are imposed changes that we do not necessarily want. So that's why I don't want to look too negatively at the matter. But if there is one lesson that we need to draw, is that it's very important that we make sure that all the European banking community, so the users of Target and possibly Euro1, but also the operator of these systems, are sufficiently represented in all these governance bodies within this standardization organization, so that our voice is sufficiently strong and as much as possible that we are speaking with one single voice. So now, that's the time for you to make use of this wonderful gadget here. If you were asked what is the most important aspect that we have to take on board for determining the speed at which we shall enrich the payments standards, what would you say? So we have three proposals. The first one is, well, we have to go ahead because that's where the value is for the banks and for the clients. So we have to go ahead to quickly reaping the benefits that are offered by ISO without waiting for too much. So kind of fast track. And irrespective of the speed at which the others elsewhere could be moving. That's option A. The second option consists in envisaging a more prudent approach, perhaps, to say, well, of course, we would have to work for enriching the payment standards, but as much as possible aligned with the other RTGS or large value payment systems in Europe and in the world. So kind of, we need to move ahead, but the speed somehow will be dictated as well by these discussion with the other operators. So kind of medium to low speed. And the third option is, well, it relates to this dependency with correspondent banking, and select this option if you consider that maintaining a backward compatibility with correspondent banking is what counts the most for you, and which would mean, I would say that it's urgent to wait. So now you have some seconds to vote. So one, two, or three, depending on these options. And I hope that this device is going to work well. Even if you have the chance to have more than one device around you, let's try to have something that looks as much as possible like a democracy. So you all had the time to vote, and perhaps we can see the outcome of this vote. Okay, that's interesting. I was not expecting a lot from the third category. I would have perhaps expected that it's a bit more balanced between the first and the second one. Perhaps building on this result and also showing that acknowledging that we have quasi two-thirds of the respondents that indicated two, so that it's primarily important to coordinate with the other payment system in the world. May I ask to those that pressed two, which other system in particular they have in mind? US dollar.
The largest currency, actually for us the most relevant, is indeed US dollar and euro. And I would have a difficult time to explain, you know, Siemens or BASF, why actually I'm requesting different set of information from the US or actually Europe.
And then I can reassure you that the Federal Reserve is in this body that has been set up to build the standards for high value payments. Yeah, because Paula didn't have a mic. Paula meant the Fedwire. Yes. Are there other systems? I would assume that there would also be some pressure for targets or the Eurosystem RTGS to find or to agree on the same standard with the other large value payment system in Europe, namely EBA. I think that is... That's exactly... I was expecting that you take it as a given. Good. That's the nice input with this type of voting device. So we take it also for the rest of our analysis, keeping in mind that you are only 90 in this room and not necessarily representative to the 1,000 participants we have in target, but that could give some interesting input for the discussion. So we now back to the second item. The second item, that's the opening hours of target. Historically, the opening hours of RTGS system, they have been largely dictated by the local market. There could have been as well some cost considerations. Of course, operating a system day and night is something that is costly, or sometimes by technical limitations. What we have seen over the years is that there were a growing number of systems ancillary to the RTGS, so the other market infrastructure settling in the RTGS, that were asking for the possibility to settle their cash balances during the night. In particular, I mean, CSD is a classic example here, that they were sending big batches of transactions for securities transaction, I mean, cash legs of securities transaction. And the setup was quite favorable because during the night the liquidity was not used, so it was available entirely for supporting the settlement of these securities transaction. So that's clearly a development that we have seen already at the time of target one. More recently, or from time to time, we hear from some market infrastructure that they would like to change a bit their cutoff and to push forward towards the end of the day their cutoff and possibly to that could lead us to close target not at 6 but slightly later. That's also something that we have seen. Otherwise, not only looking at target but at RTGS worldwide, we know that there are some operators which are looking at extending or expanding their opening hours to address some very specific requests of some of their participants which are connecting remotely from other time zones. And these operators of RTGS system, they want to increase the number of hours that would overlap with the other systems and other time zones so that their participants can operate simultaneously several currencies. That's typically something we have seen in the central banks operating TGS systems, either in the Far East, that were tempted to close their system a bit later, or in the Far West to open their system earlier than they used to do. And in particular, in the context of CLS, that's something that was very relevant. That has never been, to be very clear, a request that we have received in Target. We have the chance to be just in the middle. Fortunately, the concept of the Greenwich Meridian is a European concept. So we are in the middle of the day, and we are less exposed to that type of requirement. But in Target, what we have seen in terms of extending the operating times was when we moved to Target 1 to Target 2, that there was a strong demand from all the communities to all have access to settlement during the night. So that's something that we have generalized when we moved to Target 2. That slot, so the night settlement in Target, as you know, is not open for normal payments. It's restricted to the ancillary system business, mainly used by the CSDs, as I have already said. But nevertheless, what we have seen in the last 2 to 3 years is the growing interest of another type of animal, if I may say, of the ACHs, to also take part to night settlement in Targets, mainly pushed by some business requirements stemming from SEPA. So the night settlement is not only for the CSD, it's also for the retail business and for the ACHs. That's why, despite the fact that most of the CSDs are going to migrate to T2S, there may still be a need, that's what we expect, for Target 2 to maintain some night settlement during, some settlement phases during the night. Even more recently, when all the discussions have emerged on the instant payment solution to be developed in Europe, we got this time very clear request from the ACHs pointing out that the operating times of Targets are a bit outdated, or that at least it does not correspond exactly to their needs, and that makes that question of opening hours very relevant as well in the context of this strategic review of Vision 2020. If we look now at on the technical side, this type of requirement of the extension of the operating hours, it's very important for us that we have it right from the start. So we are now setting the foundation of the new TGS system. It's typically one of the requirements that need to be there from the start. It's extremely difficult to develop a system having specific operating hours and later on expanding them possibly towards 24 hours a day. The system needs to have some time for itself, for housekeeping, for maintenance activity, for archiving, and doing that in parallel with settlement. That's something that you need to consider right from the start. That's why this issue or this question of the operating hours in Target is extremely relevant. Now, beyond the background, what could be the options that we have? Well, the magic expression when you are referring to operating times, which could also represent the holy grail for some of the ACHs that want to develop in instant payments, that's this 24/7/365. I don't say that we are going to move in this direction. I just illustrate that when referring to operating hours, these are the questions to be raised, and that's the point or the different dimension that have to be analyzed. If we would start with the end, so the 365, what does that mean? Well, if we were to get into that direction in Target, that would mean that there are 6 days, think it's six days in the target 2 calendar where target 2 is closed. So it's not available at all for any type of settlement service. So if we go in this direction, that means that we would have to open the system for a certain number of settlement services. That would not mean that we would open a new value date. I think that it's important to distinguish between the two, between the target calendar and the days where target is open. Typically, if we would decide to operate on the 1st of May, well, first of all, we will make a lot of colleagues unhappy, but that's something different. But we would basically open on the 30th of April in the night. We would open with the value date of the 2nd of May. We are not here considering something that is going beyond target, and that is the target calendar. This is a demand that we have already seen. There were already some ACHs approaching us and say, in particular with the Easter weekend, I mean, Thursday next week, close of business, we close the system. We only reopen in the night between Monday and Tuesday. So for 4 days in a row, the system is not open during the Easter weekend. And that can be an issue for some markets, in particular where there is regulatory expectation that the payments are settled within a certain number of either calendar days or local business days, which are not necessarily the same as the target business days. So we know already that it is an issue in some communities. Now, if we look at the second dimension or the second magic number, so the 7, reaching 7, that means that we should propose to provide settlement services during the weekend. Well, that's what it means. Today we are open 5 days a week. If we move towards 7, that's what it would mean. Well, that's a challenge. That's a challenge, in particular a technical challenge, because during the weekend, all the operators of market infrastructure, in general, they are taking advantage of the system being closed to make a number of maintenance, upgrades, failover between the different regions, etc. So that would be an element that would have to be analyzed. There are also some network service providers which are not available during the weekend. There is this allowed downtime window by Swift. So just to refer to Swift as one of the many that could be serving the future, that might be serving the future RTGS system, that is an issue to be considered as well. And lastly, the last figure is the 24. So if we were to move in this direction, that would mean that we have to settle around the clock in target. That means that we need to bridge this technical window, which is here. So that's all the faces of the target business day. So we would need to see how we can skip that technical window. For the time being in target, we need that technical window between 10 p.m. and 1 a.m., Now with another technology, in particular, I think in T2S, that is a phase that can be completely skipped. So that's something to keep in mind. And also between the start of the day and the end of the day, today the system is, and for you it's like it's closed. Actually, it is operated. We are making all the homework and housekeeping of our ATGS. We are establishing the final balance of all the participants, calculating the reserve, the recourse to standing facility, etc. So we would have to see how this, if we go in this direction, how this could be tackled and arranged. Do not conclude that we aim at going in this direction of 24/7/365. It's just to grasp the difficulty that it could represent if, out of the consultation, it's something that is highlighted by the respondents. But it's still important and interesting to look at the consequences that it can have. So if we are asked, we will also have... we would also like to hear from those that are asking what should be the level of service that they are expecting. operating system during the weekend or during the night, that can mean different things in terms of level of support. Today, there is no dedicated on-site presence and support to the systems that are settling during the night. Is it something that would be required? And if yes, with which time of with which reaction time. You have to keep in mind that typically for an RTGS system, that's the costly part. In the running cost of target, it's more than half of these costs, which are human resource costs. So any very demanding requirement in this direction is going to have a strong impact on the final bill. There is also the question of... for instance, if there is a demand for opening during the weekend or during the whole night, what is the level, what are the services that should be accessible? Are we speaking about simply extending the night time settlement phase as it is today and where only ancillary systems are settling? Or would there be a demand from the market to also allow any other type of payment should be settled during weekends or during the night? So today, when you want to make an MT202, a pure bank-to-bank transfer, you cannot do it during the night. It's only for the ancillary system transactions. So if such a demand is coming, it will also have to clarify for which settlement services should this extension of operating times apply. And together with that question, actually, more generally, is it worth... does it make sense keeping the distinction that we have between the RTS, which in our jargon is real-time settlement or day trade phase, and the NTS, nighttime settlement? Today we have this distinction because the level of service and the settlement services which are provided are not the same. Is it something that needs to be maintained or not? Now, what could be the expected benefits? Well, there are benefits for the market and for the Eurosystem. For the Eurosystem, because we would better support the market needs. And of course, we are operating our RTGS system, having in mind to contribute to a higher efficiency of all the banking communities and also to foster innovation. So that's certainly one of the benefits that we would see. The second benefit could be that we are attracting new business. If we are speaking about instant payment, that would be a new business. And at the end of the day, attracting new business means attracting new revenues for Target. And that would make the financial equation nicer and easier for us to reach to fulfill the cost recovery principle. We would, however, have to analyze whether the new revenues, that's always the same story, can be offset, whether the cost can be offset by the new revenues. Lastly, one of the benefits that we could see in these extending operating hours is that at the end, we would spread more evenly the operations, being the volume or the value, throughout more hours. Which means that for us, in case there is a problem, a technical problem on the platform, the impact on the operations are lower than what it could be when the operations are concentrated around less hours. That's marginal. It's not changing radically the picture. Another benefit that could be highlighted is with this spreading of this activity throughout or over more hours is also for the banks that the conflicting usage of the liquidity is lower when, again, you are spreading your operations around the clock. Now, this being said, again, some elements to be kept in mind. I have already highlighted the cost implication. If we get into this direction, or if we go into this direction of 24/7, 365, either one of these dimensions or the three of them together, it's going to give rise to significant cost. That's relatively clear, in particular when the level of support that is expected from the market is close to what we have during the day. The Second point is that the extending operating hours, they also have some organizational implication on your side. Because today, during the night, you are only having ancillary system transaction, which is by definition highly predictable. Now, if we were to open the night settlement to other transactions than purely ancillary system settlement, well, you would lose this element of predictability, and you may also need to maintain some night presence, on-site night presence on your side. And in general, opening during the night, in particular for all type of transaction, is going to make the job of the treasurers almost a full-time job and around the clock as well. So that's to set a bit the background. So now, again, coming with my questions. And looking only at the bank-to-bank transaction, so the pure payment business, the one that you can do today between 7 in the morning until 6 in the evening. So the time where target is open for any type of transaction. And the question is, do you see a need that, or would you be calling or advocating for these times remaining what they are? Because you are happy with it and you don't think that there is any need to expand these hours where all operations can be done. That's option A. You may see a need, or you already see a need, to adjust these times, but only marginally, perhaps for 30 minutes, 1 hour, but not something dramatic. That's the option B. And the third one, very demanding, is you see a need that this is going gradually, progressively, but towards 24/7, and having an ATGS that can settle anything at any time. And that would be the option three. Now, you use your device. I will not vote because I would have a conflict of interest here, because I wouldn't like to be called in the middle of the night for a problem on target. But so now perhaps we can see the outcome. Okay, that's the nice part of it. I would not have expected that, so we may indeed have a lot of surprise when we are opening all the response to the consultative report we've just issued. So there is a majority to expand these awards at least marginally. Perhaps I could ask to those that have pressed the button two, what would be the business case? So what would you have in mind to increase marginally? It would be to achieve what, or to perhaps align with other systems? Or what would be the, or what was the reason for those, for the half of you that pressed the second button to make that choice?
For instance, the overlap in the morning with Asia?
Yeah.
Oh, I think everyone heard it. I'm very loud.
Yeah, I don't think it's really, this is what you're lacking right now, because it's a big lack of more.
Sorry, I totally agree. The big lack we have right now in our current system is the discrepancy in covering time zones. So if you look into FED and ships, they do operate already before, and this is a small window. We don't need 24, you know, per day. But actually, if you could consider starting at 3 or even at 1 at a.m. in the morning, this is going to help us. Why is this important? In particular, because of the risk measures right now, we are all actually in correspondent banking looking into and coming to, you know, financial crime. There is a big migration towards serial settlement of commercial payments. So these are not necessarily bank-to-bank transactions, but really on the underlying commercial businesses done by our corporate clients. And in order to deliver that, we would need actually a window which will support the Asian hours.
Okay, it will.
I think we can also mention the other RTGS in Europe, like CHAPS, specifically because some other national central banks allow to provide intraday liquidity to their members with foreign cash collateral. Again, this is a way to have a kind of single pool of collateral for a treasurer dealing with multiple currencies, because I don't expect to see a shared collateral pool across RTGS maybe in 20 years, maybe, I don't know. But at least with this possibility, we can somehow share HQLA's prudential buffers to cover liquidity needs in other RTGS systems. So that's something that the Bank of England is offering. Mm-hmm. And in order to have this consistently during the day, we should somehow have SHAPS and Target 2 being aligned in terms of operating hours. So that could be an argument to have something later.
So to open a bit earlier to cope with Asia, to close a bit later for to cope with the chaps in the UK. So too marginal adjustment may mean at the end a significant adjustment overall. But that's thank you for your input. That's already very valuable.
Maybe one point. What is interesting? In none of the answer you consider the weekends and holidays.
The payment side. Not on the payment side for me, but on the settlement, it's another story.
Liquidity transfers. So at least we can keep the weekends to do testing.
Well, if you would speak to the ACHs making instant payments, perhaps they would have other type of requirements.
Yeah, but that's why I was... But it's not coming. There was someone who wants to speak here, I think. No? Okay.
Then move ahead, because I'm behind schedule. Thank you. Now, the multi-currency services. As you may know, right from the beginning, T2S was established as a multi-currency platform because it was the idea not to offer something only for the euro area, so not to be euro-centric somehow. So that's why, right from the beginning, the platform was designed as a multi-currency. So, of course, bringing together the target and the T2S platform gives rise to this question, and what about Target? Would there be some benefits in also making Target a multi-currency platform? It's a bit like for the operating hours. It's better to take this requirement right from the start, because designing a system in a multi-currency dimension right from the start, perhaps the cost is relatively marginal compared to a single currency system. While if this requirement is coming later on when the system is already in operation, it's almost mission impossible. So that's why we are coming with this question during our in the context of our strategic review. There are other examples of RTGS which are operating in multi-currency. So that would not be a premiere. There are some examples elsewhere in the world. However, most of the time when there are multi-currency RTGS systems, it's something that it's like the system is cloned. So the software and the hardware is copied. It's not really integrated on the same platform. Most of the time it's cloned. And also it's almost systematically systems which are running in commercial bank money. So it's offshore systems. It's not at all, and if you take the example of what the HKMA is doing, it's really that. They are replicating the RTGS system and working in commercial bank money. Now, in the case of Target, in its multi-currency dimension, it's not what we would be speaking about. There would not be a cloning. It would be integrated. So the system like T2S today, it's one single platform that has the possibility to hold accounts in different currencies. So we would somehow replicate, or how should I say, we would apply that same logic to the RTGS accounts. We would not be speaking about an offshore system. That would not be commercial bank money. That would be central bank money. Because there would be that would result from the decision of a central bank to outsource its RTGS services on that platform. So it would be like the DCAs today, tomorrow in 2018, when we have the Central Bank of Denmark bringing the kronas on the DCA, there will be central bank money. Now, obviously, we are not asking the market for any support in this. At the end of the day, it's primarily the decision and the sovereign decision of central banks to outsource their RTGS services and the management of central bank money to a separate platform or a platform that they do not operate. However, this is not a purely theoretical exercise, I can say, because there are already some interesting questions that we start receiving from non-Eurosystem central banks. Nothing that is really committed, but we strongly believe that it's not a pure theoretical study case. Now, what it would mean to operate the new RTGS system in a multi-currency environment? Well, that's a simplified representation of what we have today in T2S and T2. You have here the securities accounts, so that's not so much what we are speaking about. You have here the cash accounts, possibly in different currencies that we are holding on the T2S platform. You have target 2 on a separate platform connected to T2S, and the non-Eurosystem central bank that are outsourcing the cash accounts on the T2S platform, but developing a link with an RTGS account, with an RTGS system that is outside of this platform. And what we could envisage for tomorrow would be something like that, basically. That we have an integrated platform that would include T2 and T2S services, where we would operate RTGS accounts not only in euro, but also in another currency. Still, the central banks would have the possibility to choose joining T2S without joining the RTGS, or even the other way around. I mean, at the end, the two things are independent, even though one can expect that there is a kind of link or logic in taking the decision to bring the two types of cash accounts on the platform. There is a kind of correlation between these two decisions, because the services that the Eurosystem would be offering to manage the cash account and the RTGS accounts, it's something that is well integrated. What could be the benefits that one could expect from that? The benefit there, first of all, for the banks which are active in the euro area and which are also having activities in these countries where the central bank would take the decision to outsource its RTGS account on the platform. With only one set of functionality, you could cover two markets and necessarily limiting your costs in terms of investment or running cost. Symmetrically, there would also be a benefit for the banks in these countries making the choice to outsource their RTGS services if these banks are also participants in Target 2 today. The benefits would be the same. And even another one for them, it's like that would make easier for their banking community the day at which they are joining the monetary union. When the euro becomes their currency, then they have already all what they need, not only technically but also in terms of business practices, to ease the adoption of the currency of the euro as the currency for this community. Now, as a side issue, I would say, one should also note that the development of a multi-currency RTGS may create opportunities to settle payment versus payment transactions. Of course, among the pair of currencies that would be operated on the platform. Well, at the end, we can, on the T2S platform, have this conditionality in the settlement between the securities and the cash, so the DVP. And if you can make a DVP, the marginal effort to make to also make a PVP is not necessarily something that is too difficult. I do mean that it is a byproduct. By no means we aim at going in the direction of multi-currency just to offer PVP. It's a byproduct. It's something that would be there per construction, but the steering element or the objective is what I have covered before, to support these communities. And it's not at all the provision of the PVP that is an objective. On top of that, we would be speaking about currency pairs that are not necessarily the most, those that generate the highest volume on the FX market. Some elements to keep in mind when referring to multi-currency services. But today, we already have a platform, T2S, that is putting together something like 23 or 24 CSDs, or that will ultimately, 23 CSDs, thank you, Mark, that will ultimately put together 23 CSDs, 24 central banks for the cash accounts. Now, if on top of that, with the multi-country dimension, we are also connecting other communities, we are just going to increase the number of actors that will be on this platform and necessarily increasing the level of interdependencies. That has a consequence, or let's say that is creating a challenge for the governance of that platform. The more actors you have, the more challenging you make the governance of that platform. When I mean governance, it's including the way the platform should be should evolve throughout the years. But that is also making the management of crisis more complex when the system is facing a technical incident. So that's something that we have to keep in mind.
Maybe one element on this one, the multi-currency dimension of T2S was also pushed very strongly by the European Parliament and so the European authorities much more. At the beginning, T2S was to be euro because it was an integration tool mostly. And it is upon the pressure of the political European Parliament that we made it multi-currency. So we expect, that's why the question is there today, that the similar situation will happen today, especially if you see the current context in which we are, in particular with the UK, the fact that we are able to offer non-discriminatory services with a currency would be certainly one point that we would have to take on board. And the point to bring it at the beginning, this question, is that it has almost no additional cost. While if you have to add a currency later in the process, then it's very costly, obviously.
Another question. Again, it's not so much whether you support the multi-currency dimension of target, because that is something which that is more for the other central banks to take a position on. But the question is focusing on this PVP service that could be provided. So if we were to develop this service among the pairs of currency that would be operated in the multi-currency RTGS platform, would you say, and that's the response one, yes, you would stand ready to use it? Response two, it's more a prudent reply, like, well, perhaps, but that depends. And that can depend on a number of factors, like the complexity of settling this transaction, what would be the pricing, what would be the operational or the legal setup, for instance. Or the third possibility is simply a no, and that you're not interested at the end for whatever reason. So take your voting device. Okay, can we see the result? Okay, again, surprise. I acknowledge that the exercise is largely theoretical, because that would also largely depend on the currencies that would eventually be operated on the platform. But I take that there is some interest for developing this activity. In any case, what we are saying in the consultative report is that anyway, that is only an idea that we need to further analyze also from a policy and oversight viewpoint. So here, as Mark said in the, earlier today, nothing is pre-cooked. That's still an analysis and a decision that needs to come later on. Yes.
I find it quite interesting that number three is taking such a large amount of the voters here, or the votes. Could we ask the ones that have voted number three, what is really the reason? True.
If there are some of, I if mean, they it's, want it's one quarter of the audience that have voted three, but if any of you would like to motivate a bit their vote. It's an anonymous vote, so I cannot force them, obviously. Well, I mean, that could indeed be one of the reasons, yeah. But CLS is doing
CLS
a different
CLS is
business,
doing yeah. clearing. It's not only doing PVP. So
here it would be the settlement of individual transactions. Huh?
It's quite different. Huh? On the contrary, CLS would benefit from this service, probably.
Good, and move ahead. Account management, account setup. So today we have RTGS accounts and other types of accounts which are on target. Huh? So that's for one side. And then we have the DCA, which is on the T2S platform. And of course, if we are consolidating the two platforms, the questions that comes naturally is, shall we also consolidate or merge the accounts? The way the accounts are set up in a market infrastructure like an RTGS, it could be seen at first sight like it's a technical issue. But actually, you will see that it goes far beyond the technical setup of the accounts or the technical elements. It's also having implications on the way the participants are making use of the liquidity that is held on these accounts and ultimately on the liquidity efficiency of the system as a whole. Now, what would it mean? What are the two options? One option to merge the account, the other option to leave the account as separate pots. So if we are multiplying the accounts, and I'm not speaking about targets specifically, but for an RTGS in general, when you are multiplying the accounts, of course, you allow the participants to dedicate the amount of the liquidity to a specific market need, and you are sure that the liquidity is going to be used primarily for that purpose. But that's, of course, always the idea, and that you make sure that your liquidity is used for the most critical transactions that you have. However, when you are having a multiplicity of accounts, you are splitting the liquidity across these different pots, and you are eventually increasing the funding needs for the participants. On the other hand, when you are merging the accounts, you offer some type of pooling mechanism, built-in pooling mechanism, which could be theoretically reducing your funding needs. But you need to solve the problem of the conflicting usage of liquidity, because you shall not take the risk that your liquidity is used for the first payment or settlement request coming to your account, because this may not be the most urgent one, and when the most urgent one is coming, there is no liquidity any longer. So that's always the dilemma between these two models. We also have to keep in mind that the setup of the account is even more complex. That question is even more complex for the participants that are not only managing their own liquidity, but they are also holding funds on behalf of their clients or indirect participants, for instance, which could justify a further segregation of the liquidity. So over the years, there was a certain practice that has developed in Europe, where the TGS account is seen as a kind of pivot for the management of the liquidity of the banks. And then as satellites around the planet, you have different pots of liquidity on accounts which have a specific usage. And the DCA is a very good example. And at the end of the day, all the funds are somehow repatriated to the RTGS. And the RTGS is the pivot because that's from where that's the account from which the banks are squaring their position with the central bank. So that's a bit the approach which has been commonly observed in Europe. So that's for the background. Before we move to the different solutions which could be adopted, there is also a dimension we need to refer to is the organization of the banking groups. You have banking groups that, for different reasons, for legal or for organizational or just because they find it more practical, they want to multiply the participation in target. We have not as many as what we had in target one, but we still have in target two banking groups that have more than 5 or 10 accounts sometimes. That is also bringing some complexity to this analysis. What are the different options that we have? So that's starting from what we have today. As I was saying, we have the accounts which are spread across the Target 2 platform. We have the RTGS account, which is the pivot. And then we have other accounts which are held on Target 2 for the sub-accounts, for those that are familiar with the ancillary system settlement. You have as well a home account in some countries, accounts for the standing facilities, and there is also as a kind of legacy of the Target 1 times accounts that can be held in the proprietary systems of the central bank. So sometimes you would have home accounts on the Target 2 platform or home accounts in the proprietary system of central banks. That's giving a certain level of complexity to the account setup as well. On the RTGS account, yeah, these two colors are here to represent the fact that there is a possibility for the participant to reserve part of its liquidity for either the highly urgent or the urgent business. So that's one of the tools that we are offering to the participants to precisely avoid that the first payment that is coming is using the liquidity and the most urgent one, they don't have anything any longer. And that is just to represent the fact that sometimes there are some banking groups that have multiplied the participation in the system. So the first level of simplification that can exist is that by the merger of the two platforms, T2 and T2S, the DCA would mechanically or technically be brought to the same platform as the other accounts. Well, that's the first level of integration, but something that you could expect from the idea of merging the platform. A second question or a second point on like we would like to have your feedback is what to do with this, I was referring to a legacy of the Target 1 times, the fact that there are still some accounts which are held outside of the platform. Is it something that today you see as a benefit because it is there to address specific needs, or is it something that you see as a hurdle for the management of your liquidity and your accounts in general? Another step could be, and that's relatively far-reaching already, that we have not this concept of a central account, a pivot account, and a constellation of accounts with specific purpose around the RTGS account, but everything put on the RTGS account. So a kind of universal account with which you can make any type of settlement, but where, of course, we would have to develop this concept of reservation of liquidity that would somehow reflect the level of cash that you want to dedicate to a specific business. And then why not, because we are in a brainstorming exercise, consider that even for multi-country groups or let's say banks that today have more than one participation in target, is it something that is completely absurd, or is it worth investigating in this direction that there is only one RTGS account per group? Can we go as far as that in the some form of financial integration, but considered from the viewpoint of the organization of the banks in target. Which benefit can you expect? Which benefit can you expect? So I have already said, if you are limiting the number of accounts, there are some funding needs that could decrease. For us, it's really important to get your requirement, because here again, the setup of the account, that's something that needs to be discussed and that needs to be envisaged right from the start of the design of the system. No? So there is at the same time the dimension of putting the account together and the level of service that you are expecting for segregating the liquidity and avoiding the concurrent usage of the liquidity. The elements to be kept in mind, we are certainly going to get an heterogeneity of the requirements. I think there are some different expectations. We are going to receive different feedback from the consultation. For instance, between the small banks, small institutions that have a relatively narrow business case in target versus the very large banks that basically make all type of settlement in target. Another element of heterogeneity is going to be the way the banking groups are legally constructed. So we could have a difference in particular or slightly heterogeneous requirement coming from, for instance, the savings banks. But let's say it's very key issue. And here I would make the link with what my colleague Patrick is going to cover this afternoon, because one cannot really consider the account setup completely isolated from the discussion on the liquidity saving features. The question, well, it might be a bit difficult. We are taking you by surprise, but that's the limit of the exercise. But to choose your camp, but where would you go if now you were asked to take a decision, or let's say to give your preference? Do you think that we should go towards the model of one single account, one single pot, kind of universal model, or towards a model that is similar to what we have today, a kind of multiplicity of the accounts, with the RTGS account being in the middle and being the pivot for these different pots? Take your device. Okay, can we have a look at the result? Ooh, okay, interesting. That's interesting. Of course, it would be interesting to break the confidentiality of the vote somehow, and to see, depending on the profile of the participant, there is somehow a typical reply that is made, where perhaps the bigger banks are more in the second camp and the smaller institution in the first one. But I don't think that it is that simple, because at the end, we have more than one half of big institution in the room. Edouard.
Yes, I just wanted to press the three button, which is please allow us to choose the best model we want, depending on the institution. Typically, even for a big bank, they might decide, because they have one entity with own activities, they want one single account. And maybe they have other entities where they want to split their business with the euro systems by typology of flow. So I wanted to press the three.
I mean, it's clear. But you know, the at the end, I'm not sure that we can really afford developing the two models, because with the first one, you develop a bit more the reservation liquidity or this type of feature. With the second one, we would invest a bit more on some type of pooling mechanism. So let's say the choice is having a cost as well, but we aim at having some elements to address this very challenging and critical aspect in the consultation, Rudy?
Yeah, I think that the question may not be the right one, eh, because it's a means to an end, right? And I think the hesitation to go the full way from a user community is also because it needs to attach to the legacy. And there could be legacy reasons why you would have several accounts, even if you have all the functionality you need with the first answer. So it's a bit of both, I think.
Good. Thanks for your input. And now my last point, because I'm very late. And the lunch is getting cold.
And it's Sodexo food, so you should not stretch.
And the last one is actually a topic on which I'm very happy not to spend too much time. It's what the new technologies can bring to FMIs. FMIs beyond target again, no? Because among all the items and drivers which I presented today, it's certainly the most open and difficult to predict. So that's why rushing on this one is not necessarily something I will dislike. The world of market infrastructure is very often confronted to, you know, fashionable topics like hypes and keywords and that are popping up and that are triggering passionate debates. And in particular, that's something that you see at the occasion of Cybos. There is always the word or the topic of the year. Some years ago, there were expressions or keywords that you were hearing like resilience, like ubiquity or cybersecurity. And now it is new technology and blockchain, digitalization and distributed ledger. But I would say that beyond this fashion effect, we do want it to see and to consider very seriously this topic. So to go beyond the hype. And to look at it very constructively from the perspective of an infrastructure, what we can get from these new technologies. Because any new technology may represent opportunities, and for an operator and also for the participants, it's extremely important not to miss these opportunities. The DLT and the blockchain technology, they are... We should keep in mind that they are mainly bringing technical solutions to models or to solutions which are based on decentralized databases or ledgers. And we have to keep in mind that it's not necessarily the way we are operating the market infrastructure. When you look at the financial market infrastructure, on the contrary, we aim at avoiding dissemination of data and multiplication of data. We aim at having everything in the in a single place. We aim at having everything centralized, either for obvious security reasons, but also sometimes because we want to make sure that the asset in circulation is not exceeding what has been issued. And that's the case for the cash or for the securities. So that's why, in general, FMIs are not spontaneously the first candidate you would have in mind to make use of distributed ledger technology. But there is clearly an interest on the market. We see it very clearly. There are multiplication of initiatives, even in the payments world. There is also a growing interest on the side of central banks making regular statements on that, including our board member this morning. Now, what could these new technologies bring to FMIs and to target? Well, as I said, the FMIs, they are indeed very centralized, but there are some, there are still some databases that we manage in a decentralized way. Marco has referred this morning to the fact that all the data that we keep in target, we don't keep it in one single place, but because of resilience, we are multiplying the servers, and we are multiplying the data for resilience reasons. Today, these data are managed like they are replicated or they are mirrored, but there might also be some benefits or it may be worth investigating how the distributed ledger technology could also be used in that context. So with the 4 or 6 sites that we have, is it something that could bring something, that could bring value to the target system? In terms of, perhaps it would have a positive effect on the performance of the system, or it would make us more resilient to a cyber attack, it is perhaps reducing the cost. I mean, here that's all the dimension of the analysis that is still to be carried out. Even if we don't consider DLT and blockchain for ourselves in the way we are operating the market infrastructure, so the RTGS, the valid question could be, how could we support the other solutions on the market which are based on blockchain or distributed ledger technology? Is there or are there some specific requirements that this solution based on the new technology would have vis-à-vis the RTGS system when it comes to settling the final balance of their clearing members? Like, for instance, that the RTGS system could have access to one of the nodes to directly settle the cash position without having the classic interaction between the market, the ancillary system, and the RTGS. So that's one of the, let's say, one of the possible evolution that we could foresee. Now, we may even go beyond that, not necessarily about target, but RTGS system in general. Because if there is a readiness of the central banks to issue digital currency, that will also have an impact on the RTGS system. How to reflect that in the RTGS system for the issuance of the currency? We are not necessarily there. That goes far beyond the context of our consultation today. But that's one of the many implications that the DLT could have. At this stage, I think it's an enormous challenge to start betting on what is really going to be delivered, but also of what concrete benefits could exist for an FMI, and more generally for the industry. We can anticipate that moving to DLT in some form could have a positive effect or positive development in terms of resilience. In the sense that even if there is one of the many nodes that is unavailable, you can rely on the others, including cybersecurity. So you would need to have more than half of your nodes being attacked to put at stake the integrity of your data. That's among the possible benefits. Some caveats, though, that would need to be made in that context, because it's I said moving target. I mean, you would have articles, initiatives, papers, speeches coming every day on that topic. And it's very difficult for us in the context of this strategic review to find sufficiently concrete initiatives where we can stand back and take a bit of distance and really analyze what are the meaningful lessons that can be drawn from these experiences. In general, there is a need to, what we could say, join the dots, to have a more complete picture of this new technology discussion before we decide what would be the degree of openness of these solutions. How could they ensure a sufficient level of protection against anti-money laundering, cyber risk? What would be the regulatory framework that would be applied to these initiatives? That's still in the gray zone. Lastly, we are central bankers, and we are more known as conservatives than geeks. So we would like to look at it with a cool head and cold blood, and to see beyond the hype what are the real opportunity, and that's really the challenge that we are facing. Another question. that there are passionate discussions on DLTs and new technologies, and it's a bit like discussions on religions. There are those that believe, those that do not believe, those that believe but just a bit, or those that practice a lot. So in which camp are you? Do you think, and for that you will press one, that it's the future? That's definitely the direction we should take. Do you think that it's not necessarily the future, but that's an interesting set of opportunities that are offered, and we should look at it very seriously? The third is a bit more, taking a bit more distance, that it's only relevant for specific niches, in particular in the world of payments, or number four, just a hype. Can we see the outcome?
Still clicking, no?
Okay, so that's, I would say, relatively in line with the approach that we had, so to take the time to look at it seriously. Of course, I could ask those that voted for four if 20 years ago they would have said the same on the internet. But that, since we do not know who has pressed number four, I think we can, for interest of time and to main and to make sure that the buffet is still
decent,
warm, to stop here and perhaps to take the questions either during the lunch for those that would like to approach any of us, or to take them shortly when we are resuming after the lunch.
Yes, thank you very much, Sylvain. So the lunch is served just behind. There is a place for that. There is a buffet. Just for you might not have seen, if you have not looked at your BlackBerry too much, but there have been some incidents in Brussels, unfortunately. There were some terrorist events. So for the one who have to commute back to Brussels, if we can help, tell us. We can try. Just for the ECB staff, all ECB staff, a priori, was safe. The one who is there, at least we have the message from... our management. Good appetit.